Hello, welcome back to Gordon's channel. We've come to lesson 17 of our to-do list app series. And in this lesson, we are going to implement the feature of editing the entries. And in this lesson, the learning objective will be event delegation, model box, the event click of Full Canada, the event background color of Full Canada, and some pseudo class of the CSS, the colon env child with an even as the argument. So let's go to what we have done in the lesson 16. And in lesson 16, we have implemented with this button, which is the incomplete first. So if we click it, we will rearrange the sequence. And now in this lesson, we are going to implement the edit entries. And first of all, let me introduce, in this lesson, we are going to use two different ways, two different implementations. The first one is like this library called Hands on Table. So if we click into it, the official site, we can go to demo. And this is an Excel-like experience to make a HTML JavaScript table, which is just like Excel. So for example, we can click into the table entries and edit here. So this is to edit here, and we can also drag to rearrange the order. For example, we can drag this and rearrange the order like this. And this is the first implementation to be able to edit the entry at itself. So let's try to build this with vanilla JavaScript. So here we want to create that when we click on it or double click on it, then we can go to edit it. So let's go to our JavaScript file, and then let's try to implement this. So this is what I want to introduce is event delegation. So first of all, we need to add the information in these cells. So let's go to our render row. So when we render the cells, for example, I want to make this to do being able to edit once I click on it. So I will go to add a element, add a class to it. So let's add a class to the, let's add a dataset information to the TD. So first of all, I will go to the cell which I am creating for the to-do list entry, to-do cell. And here I will add one more property, this one. So TD element2.dataset.id equals to the ID of this object. So here, this ID is a UUID. So let's save it and see if it is added successfully. So now, if we click on it, we see it will have the data ID attribute on this TD. So this is the ID, and every TD will have this data attribute. And then we can go to add a event listener. So on this TD element 2, this is for the edit on cell feature, lesson 17. And here we will go to add a event listener. So add the event listener. And suppose if we add on the click event, then it is sometimes we want to just want to copy this information. So we don't use single click, we use double click. And the double click is DBL click. So DBL click, and then we will run a callback. Let's say it is called allow editing. And then the bubbling force. No, so now we will go to set this allow edit. So let's go to create this allow edit, which is let's define it inside the scope of the render row. This is delete item. This is checkbox click. So let's define it here. Function allow edit. And this is a click event. So let's call it event, with a event object as the argument. And here we will check the event target, and the event target, let's store its inner text in somewhere. Let the current text equals to event.target, and then dot inner text. And then we will go to clear this event target, event.target equals to dot inner text, inner HTML. Okay, let's now we are removing the event target. So let's try it first. Now if we have double click on a to-do list entry, we have removed the inner text of this cell. So this is only removing. And now instead of removing, we are going to replace it with an input element. So let's go to create it. So we will let new input element or temporary input element be let's say temporary text box be document.create element, which is an input element. And let's append this child as the child of the event target. Dot append child, the input element, temporary text box. And this temporary text box should have a value of our inner text. Temporary text box dot value equals to the current text. So let's save it. Now if we click on it, we can see that it becomes a text box with to-do 2. And if you click on this one, it becomes a text box of to-do 1. And now it's not removing because I only have implemented the changing to a text box. So now, what do we do? So just like this one, at the beginning of our lessons, we don't use the add button, but in when we change it, in the when we have applied a change here, for example to do 7, then once we have used enter to commit the change, then it will be added to our table. So same here, we will use the change event listener. So the temp text box will have an event listener with the change event, and it will trigger a callback. Let's call it on change. So we can use on change here because this is inside the scope of allow edit. So on change with the bubbling of false, then we will define this on change. So we will have an event target. So we will use the event target, let the changed value be the event target and dot value. So this is the new value. So let's try to console log it first and see if we are doing it successfully. Changed value. It is important to do console log every step. So now let's go to a console, and if we click on something, and if we change it, so to do changed. If we change it, then we will log to do to changed in the console. So this is getting the value successfully. Now we are going to store this value, update our array based on this value, and then re-render this entry. So here we can say update it. So to do list dot find. So we can do it with this way. So we will loop over the to-do list, and each to-do list is a to-do object, and for each to-do object we will do something. So first of all, we will check whether the to-do object dot ID is the same. So if the to-do object dot ID is the same as the current ID, so we will need to check the current ID. And the current ID, it is not stored in the input element. So if you use the inspect, we see that this input does not have the ID but on its parent element. So we can use the parent element with event target or target dot parent. So dot parent node is the td dot dataset dot ID. So event target is the text box, and the parent node is the td, and the dataset ID is the data ID attribute. So let's not use the if first. Let's go to console log. Let's comment this out first. And let's console log this one first. So we are console logging event.target.parentNode.dataset.id. Let's save it. And now if we click on it and then go to console, and if we change something, for example, we change it, just change. And then we can see that we are console logging the ID of this entry. And if we try another one, say this one, if we change it, and then we can see that we are console logging the ID of this entry. So we are console logging successfully. So now we can safely use this snippet. So we have using looping over the to-do list and checking whether the ID of that entry is the same as the ID stored in this TD. And if so, we will replace it. So to-do object dot to-do will become the new value, the changed value. So this is how to change it in a table. So let's try it. So now if we have say to-do 2, and let's use to-do 2, change that. If we save it, nothing changed. Okay, so we have already changed it in the data in the local storage. So if you go to the local storage and check the first one, then it becomes the to-do 2. We have not saved it yet, but we have changed the to-do list. So let's go to save it. When we call save it, we have saved it in the local storage. So let's save it. So if we have applied it, say to-do 2 changed. Now we have updated our local storage to to-do to change. If we refresh it, then we can see that it becomes to-do changed. But we want to change two more things. First one is we don't want it to still be the input value text box. We want it to become an inner text again. So here we will say the TD event.target dot inner text. The parent node. So we can, this is event.target.parent node is the TD element, and we can say is in the text equals to the new value, change the value. So we can do it in this way. So let's say if we now we go to click it and we say to do change to do 2. After saving, we can see that it becomes back to to-do 2. But now we want to change this one to the full calendar one too. So we will go to change it to full calendar. And to change it, we can go to find it in the, for example, we have it in here. In the callback here. For example, we can go to get event by ID with the ID and then use the remove and add a new one. So let's go to do this. So on change, we will go to do this too. So because this ID, we are using it repeatedly, so let's store it in a value for simple. Let's ID equals to event target event dot target dot parent node dot dataset dot ID. And now let's use this ID into here. Let's put it here. So find the ID, and here we don't need to use this whole one. We just use ID because we have get it and store it in a local variable called ID in this on change scope. So here, after removing it, we will go to add it again. Here, we don't do it here, but we do it here. If the to-do object.id is the same one, then we will add the event. And add event is we have defined here. Add event. So we will pass the event to it. So we will call the add event function. But what do we pass to it? We will go to our render role here. Add event ID title start date. So we will copy this one and put it here. Add event. ID is the ID this one, and the title is not input value, but the change the value. And the date should be the same as the date of this object. So it should be to do object dot date. Object dot date. So the ID is the ID of this to do object. The title is the ID. Is the to do value of this to do object. So this is the add the event to the calendar. So let's save it and let's try to make some change to it. So suppose we are now, let's say if we change the to do one, which is here in the July 17th, if we change it to do one, change that. And then we can see that both the to do list in the table and the to do list in the item in the full calendar is changed. Because we have add this part to remove it first, and then we render the title to it. So this is how to make changes, which is similar to the Excel format, Excel table. So this is how to use the event delegation. And the next one is, and oh, this is not event delegation. So for event delegation, what I mean is I can also do the same one on the other type of the entry. So for example, the date, the time, and the category, I can make change to these two. So I will go to define an other function. So let's call it function. Let's call this function on table clicked. On table clicked, and I will have an event target. This event object is referring to what I have clicked. So I can say console log the event target. So here I have the on table clicked and event target. And if I want to implement on this three, the date, the time, and the category two, I don't need to do three more times. I don't need to do this three more times. I just need to do it once in the document. So here in the add event listeners, I will go to add one more event listeners. So this is event listener is for the part 17, the event delegation. So here it is added on the document, document.add event listener, and the click event. And this one I will call the function which I have just added, which is on table clicked. Okay, so instead of adding on the document, I can use it on table click. I can add on a table, but let's call it document first and let's see what console log gives us. So if we use the inspect to switch on the console, go to console, and now if we click on something, for example click on the title, we see we have logged the title. If I click on this one, we see we have logged the span. If we click on the caption, we see we have get the caption. And if we click on the full calendar, we have logged the whole full calendar. So this is how to use the event click listener on the whole document. We can use the event target to see what we are clicking. And now we can focus this not on the whole document, but only on the table, which is the we have not get it. So let's get it here. Document.get element by ID. And the ID is to do table. So document.getElement by ID dot to do table dot add event element click. So now if we click on something else, we don't see the console log, but if we click on the table, we see which cell we are clicking on. And if we click on some checkbox, we can see that we are clicking on some checkbox. So here we can go to add some conditions inside. So for example, instead of console log in the target, we can say if the event target don't match TD, for example. If it match TD, then we console log the event target. Otherwise we don't console log. So let's try it. If we click on some this one match is not a function, so the function should be matches. So let's try it. So if we click on some cells, then we have triggered it. But if we click on the checkbox, then it is not console logging, because checkbox is not TD, it's input. And here we are going to use the we are going to check further. So this one is not be the caption, it should be the contents. So we will need to add some data set to these elements. So let's add data set to them. So let's call it entry. Let's call it entry. So let's add the data set to all of them. Let's put this part later, because let's put it here after this one. So TD element 1, we have TD element 1, TD element 2, TD element 3, stage element, time element, TD 2, TD 3. And then we have the time element, data set .id equals to id, data time element .data set .id equals to id. And then we have the category. The category is this one, td element 3. So we have the stage element, the time element, and the td element 2 and the td element 3. So let's go to add the TD element 3 to dot data set dot ID equals to ID. Let's store the data set ID into all these four cells, and let's remove this one. Now we have four TD with the ID. So let's go to check it. So now if we click on some other empty cells, say the first row or this row, we can still log the TD. But now if we wait one more checking in the matches. So here we are going to check if we have the data set .id. So let's try it. So now if we click on this one, we don't see anything. But if we click on the time, so let's go to not use this data set ID. Let's go to add a data set. Stage element dot data set. Let's put this here. Data set dot editable equals to true. Let's add this editable equals to true. And let's go to use the console, inspect it. So when I click inspect, I can see that it has data editable editable equals to true. So I don't need the I here. Editable equals to true. And now you can notice that the type change here. So it is originally I have assigned the boolean here. So you can see from the blue color it is a boolean value true. But after I have stored it onto the HTML attribute, becomes a data hyphen editable, becomes the double quote. So this one becomes the string true. So here we will go to here and we will check whether it has the data set editable equals to true. event.target.matched.td and event.target.dataset.editable equals true. So let's try it. So now we have here we have the table. If we click on some other cells, then nothing changed. But if we click on these items, then it will console log it, because it has the attribute data editable equals to the string true. So now we are targeting this successfully. So now what we will do is, if it is true, then we will change it to the different input box. So we will switch it. Switch the event.target dot dataset dot type, for example. So we will set a type attribute here. So we will go to set the type. So the type is, for the date, it is the type of date. For the time, it is the type of time. For the this one, it is the type of text. Let's not call it text, let's call it the same as the element the stored in the local storage. So let's go to call it, not call it test, let's call it to do and the category. So let's call it to do, type equals to do. This one is the type of time. So this one is a string date. This one is a string time. And this one is a string called category. And here this is all type. Type. And the type. So we have the date, time, to do, and category. So now we will use the switch and check whether we have successfully. So dataset type, if it is date, then we will do it according to the date. So let's console log date and break it. Yeah. And if it is the time, then we will console log time. The reason that we are not console logging the type directly because I want to check the switch statement too. So if it is to do, then I will console log the to do. And break. And then if it is the category, then I will console log the category. And then I will break. And then I have a default. Default. Okay. So this is, let's try it. So now in the console, if we click on the date, we see date. If we click on some time, we see to do, we click on category, you see category. So we are using the click event listener on the table and check whether the data set, what is stored in the data set. So now for different cases, we will type different, replace the inner text with different the different type of input. So for example, for the to do, we will replace it with the to do. So and this part is basically what we have done previously here on the allow edit. So we will get the inner text, store it in here. So this is what we will do. So let's go to replace it first. So we will get the inner text and store it and create an input and put it inside. So let's go to append chunk. So here we have actually what we can do is we will create an input element anyway, and we can put it here. We will create an input element and then we will append it as the child on the event target. So this is not type box, this is input element. So But now the type of this input, the value, if it is to do, I will put the value as the current value. So event.target.value. I will do this after I have changed the value. And if it is category, I will do this too. So I will put the temporary tables as the, and then append it as the child. But then if it is, so I can, instead of using break here, because these two is the same, so I will put it here. For the case of to do and the category, it is basically the same. And I don't need this break here. But for the case when the type is date or time, then I will set the type. So input element dot type is the same as the dataset dot type date. And for this one, the type of the temporary input element will be time. And then what I will do is put the value. But now for the time, I can put this value. But for the date, if I put this value, it will be some problem. So let's try it. For example, let's try it first. What the problem is. For example, I just put it the same in this way. So now it doesn't allow us to render because there is an error in line 368. So let's go to 368. So here we cannot use let here. So let's go to put it here. So here, let's go to input temporary input element has already been declared. So we shouldn't declare it here. So let's go to let it inside this scope. And not use the let, just call it temporary input element. Okay, let's do it in this way. Now we have do it successfully. So we have in the functional scope, and then in the block scope of the if condition, we have the let the temporary input element. And in the switch statement, in different cases, we have assigned it as the created input element with different type. So if it is the date, we will have an input element of the type date. If the dataset stores the time, then we will have the input element of the type time. And for the to do or category, then we don't set its type and the default is test. So let's try it. So if I click on some of this one, so this one is set temporary text box is not defined because I have not changed it here. So we shouldn't use temporary text box. We use temporary input element. So we have replaced it. So let's save it. And now if I click on some text, then it is also having some problem because it is keep telling me undefined. So here I should do something here. So for the event target, the dataset of type, then I will create an input element, but first of all, I will need to clear it. So I will need to clear the event.target. So before append it as child, I will do it like this. So outside the switch statement, but inside the if statement, I will say the event.target will be of an inner text. Will be nothing, so I will clear it up first, and then I will append the input element as the child. So let's change it. So let's try it, save. And now if I click on it, then it has become a input element. And every input element is not having a value here because I need to get it. So here for the input element value is not be the value of the event target, but the inner text of the event target. Inner text. So let's save it. Now if I click on something, it will change to the inner text of this target. This way. And here I need to change it too. So let's go to here and change it. So if I use inner text on the time, then if I click on the time, then we can see it is still work. It will be the time of the original value. But if I click on the date, let's say I add it as the inner text of the original TD, and if I click it, it is not going to show the date because the value of a date input element is not of this form. This form is after we have used the to local string. So we will need to not use this, but we will need to look over the table. So we will need to find it in our object. So let's go to so one of the easiest way is to store it in our dataset again. So the dataset. So here, when we create a date element, we have used the formatted date. So we have created a new date object based on the date string, and then we will use some format. So here, but we are going to store this date original value. So I will store it in the date element. Date element dot dataset dot value equals to the date. So I don't need to keep it string, I just call it date. Now let's equals it, and now let's go to our switch statement, and here let's create this one. So the value is not the inner text but the dataset.value. So I have stored it in the dataset. So if I click on it, cannot read the property value of undefined. So let's go to inspect it and see if we have added successfully. So we have data hyphen value with the 2020 as hyphen 07 hyphen 717. So I'm trying to get this value. So let's go to here. Event.target is the TD and the dataset.value. So, and it is giving us an error that we cannot read the property value of undefined. So here, if I click on it, we are getting this error on line 373. Line 373, event.target.dataset.value. So here we need to check which one is undefined. Cannot read property value of undefined of HTML table element on table clicked. So here, let's go to change it, not using the value. Let's use it as this one. I have a spelling mistake. This is not date set, this is data set. So after saving it, if I click on some dates here, the input element, the date input element is successfully having a default value of the original value because I have stored the original value in the data set value, which is here. So if I double click to inspect, we can see that it is storing the original value of the date input element format in the data attribute called value. So this is how to set the default value. And now what we want to do is similar to what we have implemented here. So when we have the allow edit, we will also have the change. So when we have changed the input element, then we will have this one. So we will call the onChange, find it in the to-do list and update it. So let's try to implement it in a generic way. So here, after we have on table click, we need to have an onChange. So here I will go to let's add the event listener on the temporary input element. So temporary input element dot add event listener. So these are input elements. So the event listener is change event listener, and then I will call a function. Let's just call it onChange. Okay, let's just call it onChange. And then we have the false as the public. Now this one is on change is inside this scope on table click scope. So I can just copy it. Let me just copy this part from here. And then we can make some slight edit on it. So let's put it inside the scope of the on table click. Yeah. So this is the scope of on table click. If I use this, I can see that I have added this on change function in the scope of on table click. So here on change, we have an event, which is the change target, which is the input element. But all the data is stored in its parent node. So I will also get its ID from its parent node. So first of all, we will go to the calendar and remove the same element with that ID. And then we will loop over the for each and check the to-do object. And if the ID is the same as the ID, then we will go to do this. So we will go to update the value, but we don't only update the to-do, we will check which one is changed. So let's go to so here, instead of doing the changed value, we can say to-do object, because the changed value may not be the to-do. So here, this is after we have updated the property. But now, which property to update, we will need to check it based on the parent element. And actually, this attribute is the same as this one, the date, the time, the to-do, and the category, which is the same as what we are storing in the local storage. Yeah, we can see the date, time, to-do, and the category. So we can say, use the square bracket method. So to-do object dot, instead of dot, we will say bracket, and then the type is stored in the parent element. So the parent element of this event target, which is the input element, its parent node is the TD, and we have stored in the data set the type variable, type attribute. So the type attribute, we will be date, time, to-do, category. So after this, we will assign it as the new value. So we can do it like this. So instead of using dot to-do, we will using the square bracket and get the type from the data set we have stored in a TD. So we will update the value in this way, and then we will embed the event to the calendar, and then we will set the change value again. And here we will have one more problem for the time to do and the category. This is okay but for the date, we have changed the format slightly, so it will be a different format. So let's try it. So say if we have saved it, and then if I have go to say the to do one, which is the July 17th one, if I click on it, the to do one, if I click on it, then it is changed. Let's see if I click on it. And if I click on it, it is changed. But if I click on the category, it is changed too. So let's say if I have the category 40, we will change to category 40. If I change it back to category 4, and for the category 3, let's call it something else. Yeah, it's okay. Category 3. But now if I go to change the time, it is okay too. For example, if I change the time to something else, is it okay too? But if I change the date, for example, July 17th, if I go to change it to July 15th, if I change it, say, if I change it to 15, and this one, if I change it to July 2. Now, if I change it to July 15, then you see the format of the date is changed because we have not added the formatter. So the formatter is here. The formatter is in what we have put in the render row. In the render row, we have used this to locate string to format the date. But now we are going to use it in another function in the on change of the on table clicked. So let's go to here. Let's go to add a new function called format date to use it. For function format date. and we will pass a date to it and return something. Return something. So let's go to here. Let's go to here and copy this. So we will copy this part. So we will receive a date, which is a string like this, the year, and then hyphen, and then the month, and then hyphen, and then a date. So this is a string of this format. And then we will use the date constructor to construct it. And we will use the toLookup string to format the date. And now we will return the formatted date. So we will return it. And here we will call this format date function instead of doing it explicitly. So in the render row, if we go back to the render row, here, instead of doing this explicitly, we will say format date is format date, passing the date to it. And I don't need this date constructor here. I just use the format date function and pass it to the inner text. So I can, instead of assigning a variable, I can just call it. Okay, so this is how to use it. And here I will use the same way, the format date, and then I will put it into our change object. So here on the on change here, if it is the date, and I will not only use the date change value, but I will use the format date. So I will go to here. If the event.target, the parent node dot type is date, then the event.target.parent.node.inner_text equals to the format date. So let's save it and let's go to try to change it. For example, I changed this one from July 15 to July 16. So let's say so change it from July 15 to July 16 after changing. Okay, this is still like this. So let me try to figure out why. So I have the formatted date here. I have the formatted date here. And I have the change type here. I have the comparison here. Here I'm not using parent node.type, but I use parent node.dataset.type. Dataset.type. And if I'm going to use it many times, then let's store it in a variable. Let type equals to. So let's put it as a variable. And here I don't need to get it for many times. I just call it to-do list object type. And here I don't need to type this whole thing. I just need to use type because I have stored it as a variable, local variable type. Let's style the indentation slightly. So here I have the, let's save it, and let's try to edit it, say from July 16 to July 17, let me click it and change it, and now we can see that the date is new, not in the correct format. So let's go to try to figure it out, if the type is date, so here the type is date, no problem, and then I will set the inner text of the parent node as the result of the format date function, which is here. So let's try to put this in the else statement. So let's go to try to do this. So let's try to use the if else. So if the type is date, then I will assign the parent node inner text as the formatted date, else I will just assign it as the value. So let's try it. So if I change it to another date, then it is not going to change because this one doesn't hit. So the type should be the date. Okay, the type equals to date, And here, I formatted date. I should not use formatted date. I should use the event target the value, the change the value, because I don't have the this one. So let's try it again. So if I click it, and if I change it, then we can see that the date is formatted successfully. And the reason is that I should use the new value, which is a string of the special format. So this is how to format also the date. So this is what I want to demonstrate for as the event delegation part. So here what we have done is apply the changing here. And actually now we have one module which is not used anymore. Let's go to the module inside the render row. Now this hold on change is not used anymore, and this allow edit is not used anymore because it is only for the to-do item. But now I have implemented the same logic for all the four types of different category. So let's go to comment this out. I can comment this out. Yeah, after comment this out, I can use this to hide it. So let's just delete it because I don't need it anymore. Let's just delete it. Alright. So here I have saved it. And now after the event delegation part, this is the first way of editing, which is an Excel-like experience. So we can say here we can edit it in the table. So this is how to edit in the table. But now if I want to do another way of the editing, for example, I think that this double click one is very counterintuitive. So the user may not know that they can use the double click to change the event here. They may not know that. So if I don't use this one, change at the table, I will use a model box, which is a more traditional way. So let's try it. So first of all, we will build the model box. Let's see. If I have here, we have the to-do grid parent and after the to-do grid parent. So let me comment this so I can know this one is the to-do parent. So this one is closing the to-do parent, and here I'm going to do another one for the model box. So for model box, I will create firstly something for the overlay. ID equals to to-do overlay. I will have a to-do overlay. So let's give it a class and an ID. The reason that I give it a class of the same name is because in the CSS, it is better to use class for styling. Otherwise, it will have a high specificity and it may cause some problem. So let's go to ID overlay, to-do overlay, and class to-do overlay. So let's define this one first. So let's go to the CSS file. To-do overlay. So for the to-do overlay, I want it to have a width and height of 100%, width and height of 100% of the viewport. Now we can see that we can scroll down, but we can't see it. So let's go to add a background color of a very light gray. So FFF is white. So let's add it as DDD. All right, so very light gray. So we have a whole very light gray color here. And now I want this to be fixed. Position fixed. And I want it to be top zero, left zero. So I want it to block the whole screen. Now, no matter how I scroll, I don't see anything because my FFF is blocking. So let's give it a slight opacity of 0.8, for example. So I can still see something at the bottom slightly. And now I want to add a child to it. So this one, the child is ID equals to the to-do model box. the to-do model. For the to-do model, I want it to be in the middle. So let's go to create a size for the to-do model first. To-do model has a size, let's say width of 50 VW and height of 50 VW, VH, pupil height. And then let's have a border of 1px, solid green, for example. Now I have the here I have this one, and I want its width to be 50. So now let's go to now it is having 100. Let me see width, spelling mistake here, it should be width. Yeah. Now it has 50 viewport width, 50 viewport height, and I want it to be positioned in the center, so I can apply this on the parent. So display, and then I will have a flex, and then I will have position center. Enter. Let's try it. So for the flex, we can have the position items. So position items. Enter. No. So if it is not having this, we can use justify content and align items. Enter. So how we have the model box in the center of our screen, and I can add a close button here. So let's go to add a close button here inside the to-do overlay. Let's go to add a close button, to-do model closed button. Let's give it close first. So I want to have a close button here. So let's go to dial it. Model close button. I want to style it. So let's go to, let's check the spelling first. More to do model close button. To do model close button. Yeah. So let's give it a background color. Let's say a red color. So we will fine tune it later. And then let's go to give it a position, which is absolute. So now it will go to here. And let's go to add. So let's put this. Okay, let's go to the top. Let's go to call it 50 VW. Let's call it top. Let's call it top negative 25 VH. And for the left, let's call it 25 VW. Nope, you don't see it. So let's give it 00. Now it is here, and I want it to be here. So let's give it a top of 25 VH and a left of 75 VW. Yeah. So now it is slightly outside our model box. Let's give it a width of the 20px and a height of 20px. And now let's make the text in the center. And let's not call it 20px, let's call it two font size. And I want it to be inside, so I will use a left of calculation function, 75 font width space minus, and then the width of this one, which is 2 wood element, and then minus 2px for a slight padding. Great. And here I will use the calculate function, 25 viewport height plus 2px Yeah, great. So this will be my close button, and I can start it to be run. So let's give it a border radius of 50%. So it is run. So this is my close button, and I can make it of color white, and the font weight of bold. Great. So this is my close button, and here I will go to add the table here, which is basically my table here. So let's go to my HTML and copy what we have in the here to do input. So let's copy it and put this inside my to do model box here. So let's save it first and see it. Now we have started successfully because we have this styling called to do input and to do block. So we have styled successfully, but we don't need these options. We just need to have a save button. So let's go to remove some buttons. So the incrementate first, and the span before, and the sort by date button, and span behind before. And for this one, it's not add, it's save change. And here it is not add button, it is change button. So let's save it. Now we have the to-do category, date, time, and the save change button. Great. So now we can go to put this aside, close this one. And we can see we have a different border because this border is the border of this input element. So let's use this border. So here, I don't need the green border because it is for the testing. And let's add a slight background color. Let's add a background color. So let's see what color is good. So now my color palette is of this category. So let's see if I use this color and put it inside my color picker. Inside the color picker of DevSchool, and then let's go to choose a lighter color, say this one, 90% one, and then put it as the background color of our model box. Let's put it here, save it, and see if it is nicer. Yeah, it is better in this way. So here we can have a very light background color so that we can know that this is our model box. And let's try to make this smaller. For example, if we make this smaller, make the screen small, it will shrink with the screen. But the input is outside the screen, so it is not good in this way. So let's go to not call it width, but mean width. Minimum width is 50. So here, when we have a large screen, then we have a minimum width of 50, but if we have a small screen, then it is still stretching because according to its contents. So this is the minimum width property. And here this button is doing something very strange, so let's not put it too close. Let's put it just at the upper top. So let's go to not style it here. Instead, let's style it as read element and left and right read element. Let's style it like this. So if the screen is small, then it is still outside, it is not blocking our input element. That will be greater. And I don't want the model box to have a opacity, so let's give it an opacity of 1. No, it's not working. Let's try a opacity greater than 1. No, it's not working too. Yeah. Anyway, okay, so now this is how to let's decrease the opacity here to 9. Yeah, this is better. So now this is our model box, and we can see that it has a position fixed and is blocking a view. So we will need to add a property called hidden. slide out with which is a translate transform of translate. So let's say for example I want it to be slide left, for example. Okay, slide left, translate x negative 100 viewport width, and for the not style, and for the not style I want it to have a translate here, yeah, overlay. I want it to have a transform translate. Okay, so the default is outside the screen and slide into screen, slided into screen, slided into field is translate 0. When it is 0, it is slided into the field, and it is default is slide outside the field. So let's try it. Now it is outside the field, but if we add this class name to the model box, yeah, hopefully if I add this class name to it, then it will be slide into field. So our toggling of the open model blocks open or not is to whether we add this class to this to-do overlay or not. So let's implement it with our JavaScript. So let's see if you still remember it. So let's go to click edit as the click event listener on this document first as the demonstration. So if we edit as the document dot add event listener, click. And then let's say show model box false. So the edit model box, so let's go to define the show edit model box. So still inside this to do main scope, so edit model box with the event target, because it is a click event one, so this is a mouse event. And now let's go to toggle it. So I will go to get the element, which is the to-do. The element is to-do-overlay. So this is our ID of the target element. And then I will toggle its class list. So I will use the class list API dot toggle. And the class that we want to toggle is this one, slider into field. So let's try it. So let's try this first. So now I have my to-do list, but I have now a event listener listening to the document, and when I click it, I will toggle the class of the overlay with the class slide into view. So if I click it, this one is slide into it, and if I click that, it is gone. And because I want it to slide, so I will add a slide animation. So in the to-do overlay, I will add a slide information transition transform. If you don't know which transition, you can use all. But if you use all, it's okay too. For example, now if I click it, you can see it is all. But I can also specify it to only animate the transform. So 1 second is a long time. So if I click it, it takes 1 second to slide out, and if I click it, it takes 1 second to slide out. But we can also call something called a different time step. So here, if I want it to slide out maybe slowly, it is here, transition. After I have added the class name, I want it to slide out at a time of 655 milliseconds. But if I and sliding it away, which is here without the class, I want it to slide out really quick, so 250 milliseconds. So let's try it. So if I click it and I click it again, it is go away very quickly, but it goes out with a transition. So when it goes out, people will say wow. But if we want it to go away, then it is a good way to make it go away very quickly. So here now, instead of toggling it, we will need to do two functions. First one is the show the anyway, is close the edit model box. close the edit mode box. So let's instead of add and close, so it's class list is add and the close is class list is removed. So let's do it like this. So now when I click it, it will show, but I have not close because close is to attach to this button. So let's go to find this button. So the button has a ID of to do model button. So here I will go to add the event listener. So here I will in the event listener, I will document.get element by ID with the ID of this one. Then this element will have an click event listener, which is when I click it, I will want the it to close the model box. So I will say close the edit model box callback with a bubbling of force. So let's try it. So now if I click on anywhere, it is slide out, and if I click on the close button, no, it's not working. To do model close button. So the ID is to do model close button. And if I click on it, I want the model box to close it. I will call the close model box, which is remove the slide into view class. So let's try it again. If I click on it, nope, save it, load it, click. If I click on the close button, it's not working. So let's try to figure out why. So let me see document.get element by ID. So let's try to console log this first. Let the button be, and then let's try to console log the button. Let's try to console log it. So if I click on it, and if I click on it, so I have the when I load, I have console log the close button, which is the this one, which is highlighting this one. But I have clicked it. If I say inspect it, then we cannot see the event listener. Event listener, does it have a event listener? Yes, which is the document one, which is on the 406. Which is the show edit model box, but it is not what we want. We want to close the model box. And the reason that we cannot close is because we have two event listener. So let's try to not adding this one. Not doing this on the this one. Let's go to instead, let's go to edit, add the class name to our element directly. Let's go to edit to our model box here directly, and let's see if I click on it. No, it's still not working. So if I click on this element, if I have the click event, I have only have the 406 line 406. Which is here. And only have the show edit box. But now let me refresh it. Remove it. Remove. So now let me see. Okay, now I need to add the event listener on it. So let's say button.add event listener. If I click on it, this one has the slide in the field. If I click on it, it should remove the slider into field class. So let me check the spelling. Remove the slider into field. The to-do overlay should have removed the slider in the field. So it should have to-do list close button. To-do model close button. Let's try it. Close the model box. So it will find the to-do overlay. It will call the close edit model box. If I click on it, it is still having this class name. So why is it? Let me see. If I remove it, okay, If I remove it, if I click it, and then close it. Now let's go to check the different internet. Let's try to remove this one. Now let's try to go to our HTML and then edit. Let's add the class name here. Yeah, it is default. And now we have a click event listener here. And if we inspect, we have the click signal. And if we click it, it will remove it. And the reason that we cannot remove it in the previously is because we have this event listener, which is whatever we click on the document, we will add the class name to it. So we are removing it and adding it at the same time. Then that's why it is not closed in our previous testing. So now we will want this document.element by ID. And I will want to add this event listener to it. And here I don't add the show edit model box to the document because this is for the demonstration purpose only. And instead, I will want to not add it here, but in a button. So let's go to save it. Now I don't want it to be here. So let's go to HTML and remove this one because this is for the testing purpose. Now I will add one more button in each row. So let's go to add one more button. So in the render row. Here. I will go to add the button. So I will have one more button here. So this is the add the cell. And here. What we have done here, all the dataset ID, we don't need this now because we are not using the event delegation way now. So we can comment this out because we are not using the event delegation way now. It is a good demonstration of how to use JavaScript, but we now want to use the model box way. So here, let's go to create add cell. So this is basically similar to what we have done in the delete cell. So this is similar. So here we have here we need to define a span element, which is the add this span. And this edit span should have a inner text. Let's try it. For example, edit. Let's try if it is the keyword of the material icon. Span element, we will add a event listener. And this edit span element will have a data set of the ID, which we will need it later. And we will need to have a new TD. Element, which is the edit TD, and the edit TD will have the edit span as a child, and the row will have edit TD as the child. So let's try it. So now let's see. Yeah, we can get this icon because for the material icons, it works in this way. When you have the inner text of delete, it is the delete button. And if you have the inner text of edit, then it is the edit button. So now we want to click on, when we click on this edit button, we will slide the show model out. So we will, but we don't only slide the small model out, so we need to add a callback to it. So for the callback, it is not delete item, it is allow editing. So it should be to edit item. And for the to edit item, let's go to define it here. Let's define it inside the scope of render row. So function to edit item with an event target. So here, first of all, I will call the show edit model box because I want it to show to edit model box. And then I will want to fill up the edit model box with the default value. So let's try to click it first. If I click on any edit button, then I will see the model box. Let me see. Oh, on a small screen, when we scroll up the full Canada, it has some something with a large high the EZ index, which is blocking my model box. So let's try to add a EZ index to it. So the to-do overlay, it should have an EZ index of, let's say 2, for example. Let me try it. So if I click on some of the element, if I scroll, now the full Canada is not blocking because I have set the EZ index as 2. Now it is not blocking. Otherwise, the full Canada, some of the items have a high EZ index of 1 and it has blocked my model box. Now, what I want to do next is to prefill it, fill this up by the default value, which is just like what we have implemented previously. If I click on something, it becomes an input box with the original text as the value. And now I want to fill this up with the original value. And to do this, it is very simple. So we will go to look at my table. So to do this, for each, I will look over it. Okay, to do list.find, it will accept a callback function, which is it will loop over the element object, the to-do object, and I will try to find it. Let's say I will want it to find the one with the ID to-do object equals to the ID stored in this event target. So here, I'm storing the ID in the dataset.id of the edit span. So here I will check whether the to-do object is the same as the event.id. Event.target. Okay, let's put in here. Let ID equals to event.target, which is the span. And then I will want the dataset.id. And here I will compare the to-do object.id with my current ID. And I will store this one. Let result equals to. And let's console log it. So now let's try it. So if I have click it, then I will console log the found object inside my to-do list array, because I have to use the find method of the to-do of the array find method. So here I will want to fill up based on this result. So here I will go to find the model box. So I will need to add some ID to this input elements. So for example, I will have, this is, remember this one must be inside the to-do model, to-do overlay. So here I will say ID equals to to-do edit to-do. And for the rest, I will add the ID to-do edit category. And the date, we should not call it date input, we should call it to-do edit date. And for the last one, we should call it to-do edit time. So let's get this 4 element. Over here, we have this object and I want to destructure it. So let to do category and the time equals to the and the date. And the time equals to the result. So this will destructure it from the destructure the value from the object. And now I will go to get the element document.get element by ID. So we will have four different input object with the value assigning the value. So here let's go to copy this. So here I will use the alternate. Shift alternate, press shift alternate up. Shift alternate up is copying the previous line. And now I will copy the ID to do edit to do. To do ID category, to do edit category. And to do edit date. And to do edit time. So these four elements will have the value, default value of what we have destructured. So to do, and then the category, and then the date, and then the time. So this is the default value. So let's save it, and let's try it. So if I click on this one, so it has filled the default value with what is in that entry. So if I click on another one, it has filled the default value with that entry. So great. So now we will need to add the event listener on the save change. So let's go to edit. So let's go to add the event listener. In the add event listeners, we add the event listener. So I will go to document.get element ID. So here, this ID, this button has a ID of change button. So for the button with the ID change button, I will add the click event listener. Click event listener with a callback. Let's say edit, commit ending, and the bubbling force. So let's go to define this commit edit. So let's go to define it. Function commit edit event. So the first thing we will do is actually is close the edit model box. Because after submitting a change, we don't need it to be still here. So let's say if we have click on something. So whatever change we do, if I click the save change, it also closes the model box. And now we want to implement the changes. So we will go to actually similar to what we have done previously in the on table clicked. Actually similar to what we have done in the on table clicked. So we will need to look over the to-do list and check it. So on similar to the on change. So we will go to look over it and find the one with the same ID, and then we will go to make the changes. So let's go to so instead of changing only one thing, because we are giving it a model box, so they can change anything to one more than one item. So we need to change the whole object, update the whole object. So let's go to define it from scratch. So here, what we need to do is, first of all, we need to fetch the ID. So the ID, we need to store it in somewhere. So if I click on it, we need to store it on somewhere. Let's say store on the save button. So here in the... So now we are going to use this button several times. So let's put it in the get elements. So let's in the scope here. So in the scope here, let's get a edit button. Edit button. Comma here. So we have an edit button and we want to define this edit button here. Edit button is this one, change button. Okay. So let's not call it edit button, let's call it change button. Change button. And for the change button, let's rename it in the here, change button. And here, we don't need to use this whole document.getElementById, we just call it change button. And here, we go to the... So in the to add item, apart from filling up the form, we will go to update the change button, the dataset.id, let's store it here, it equals to the ID. So we are storing it from this add button to this change button. So if we click on it now, you can see that it has a data set, which is the ID of that button. So if we go to click, say, another entry, if I click it, then we have updated the ID stored on this button. So we can now go to get it with change button.dataset.id. So let's close render row. And let's go to here. So now we will go to get the ID. Let ID equals to event.target, which is a save button, save change button, and then let's call it dataset.id. So I will get the dataset, the ID stored in the data on the save button, and I will go to use it to loop over the to-do list. So to-do list dot for each, we have loop over it. And then I will have the to-do object, and I will check whether if the to-do object dot ID is the same as the current one, which is the current ID. Then I will do something, and after that I will save it, and I will also update the entry. So let's go back to render row. So we have do that, not in the render row, but in the on table click. So on table click, which we have defined earlier in this lesson. So in the on change, we will first of all remove from the calendar. So we will remove something from the calendar, and then we, after getting the ID, and then we will loop over it and update it. And then we will add the event. So here, after doing something, we will add the event, which is based on the current to-do, and the current date, and the current ID. And then, after that, we will format the date. So, so now, yeah, it's not parent node, but we will need to go to find it. We need to update that row. So now we will need to do this assessment to this. So here, let's go to here. We will need to get the values. And for the values, actually it is in all the four input element. So let's go to here. And these are the four elements. So let's go to get them. So if the here we can so in the commit edit here we can get all the values first. So let the to do equals to this one, and then let the category equals to this one. And let the h equals to this one, and let the time equals to the value of the input box of time. So we have get this value, and if this is the same one, then we will make the changes to to object equals to. We update it. So here I will, it will be to do, will be the to do, ID will be the ID, to do will be the to do. So in the previous syntax, we need to do this like this. But in the new syntax, we can just use ID to do, and then the category, date and time. So let's try it. So let's see. So for example, if we go to the here, and if I click on something, for example, the to-do 4, if I click on it and change it to to-do 9, if I change it, then I can see that this updated to to-do 9, and inside the, you can see that the to-do 4, yeah, let me see, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is not updated yet, so this is still to do 4. So let's go to check the why. So we have updated the to do object. We have make change the to do object to a new one and then save it. So let's try to console log the to do object. Let's try to console log it. So if I click on something, if I change it, they change it, then we have console log it to do object. Let's say if I click on it and I change it, then we have changed it successfully. But whether we have saved it, let's see. No, we have not saved it somehow. So let's go to check it why. So here we have add the event, and then we have called the save function. So for the save function, it is here. Let me see. So for the save function, it should be storing what we have in the to-do list to the Stringify. So let's go to check why it is not saved. So in the commit change, we have the to-do object and we have updated. So in the console, we can see that we have updated to to-do 9. But in the application, our save function doesn't work. So let's try to see why. So in a save, so let's console log the to-do list result array after we have used the for each. Let's console log it. So let's say if I have added something, for example this one, from to-do 4 to to-do 9. So if I save it and I check my to-do list, then it is still to-do 4. So I haven't successfully updated the to-do list object. So I will need to go to check why. So I have used the for each loop and loop over the to-do object. And for the to-do object, I have go to if the ID is the same, then I will update the to-do object with ID to-do category date time. And now the to-do here I have updated. After the for loop, for each loop, it is not updated, so I need to check why. So let's try to figure out over here. Yeah, the ID is the same as this one, but it is not updated. So let's see if I am not using this one, but I'm using ID to do. Category, and the date, and the time. Let's see, if I do it like this, and if I save it, and then I go to save it as to do 9, therefore save it, and see if it is changed. No, it is still to do 4. Let me see. So here it still prints to do 4 after I have changed it here. But here in the when I console it inside the for each loop, it is changed. The to-do object is changed. So I need to make this change saved in the to-do list. So I will need to go to, if the to-do object is the same, then the to-do object is this. So here Let me see. If I change it and commit it, and then this is not changed. Let me see the reason. If I want to change the array, I can have different ways. So for example, I can, if I don't use the for each, for example, I don't use the for each. For example, if I use the for the conditional, traditional for loop. So for I equals to 0, and then the I is smaller than the to-do list dot length, and then each one I is incremented by 1. So if I use the traditional for loop, then I will go to do this basically the same thing. So I will check whether if the to-do list I, the I've one, ID of the I1 is the same as the current ID, and if so, I will do this, update the to-do. Here, I don't use to-do object, but the to-do list I, and here I will go to add the event back to the calendar, which with not the to-do object but the to-do list I. And the to-do list I. So this is what I am doing in this for each loop. So let's comment that out. And let's use the traditional for loop. So now if I go to editing, and if I change this one to 9. So after changing, and I console log the result, I have changed it successfully. So this becomes 9 now. And inside my local storage, it is also updated as the to-do 9. So that's a tricky point of the for each loop. So somehow and I loop over the array with the for each loop, and then I try to update the entry, then it is not successful. But if I try to use the traditional for loop and pointing to that entry with its index, then I have updated it successfully, and then my save is this. So this is the console log reflects that it is updated successfully, and then my save is working to store it in the local storage successfully. And now the last part is I want to update the table 2. So now I have updated here, and I want to update the table 2. So what I will do is I need to look over that row. So I will need to still need to add the data set. So I will still need this part. So I have the data set of ID inside this TD element, and I have the data set of type inside this element. So let me comment out the editable. So here I will go to find it in a table. So update the table. So here I will go to find it in a table, table dot get element. So query selector. So I will go to query it with a query string of data set. Data ID. So query selector all data ID. So let's go to query. So let the result equals to this one, and then let's, okay, I don't need to console log it now. So here let's console log the result here. Console log the result of my query selector all. So if I have console log the results of my query selector, for example, I'm editing it and changing it back to do 4. Now it says that table is not defined. So I should, instead of using table, I should go to store it as an element here. So let's go to here. The table is to do table. So let's go to define this to-do table. in the get elements, I want to get it to do table equals to document dot get element by ID, and the ID is to do table. So I want to use the to do table here. So the query selector all is on the to-do table. So let me try it. So if I change to-do 4 to to-do 9 and save the change, I can see a node list with a length of 0. So I don't find anything with the data ID. So let me try it. So if I inspect it and see, we have the data ID attribute. But if I want to select it, I have to use the CSS way, so I should say TD with the data ID attribute. So let's try it again. So with the data ID attribute, which is a string. So let's try it again. So if say I have changed something, so to do for, let's save it. And the console log query selector all on the element is not a valid selector. So let's remove this one. So let's try to get all the TD first. So if I try to get all the TD, for example, if I save it, if I make some change and then I save it, and then I can get all the TD inside this. But now if I want to say this TD has a data set, but let's go to find the data set. I want to it to check whether it has the data set of ID, for example. So let's go to find someone, for example, category cell, and then TD category cell, and I want to find it whether it has the data set of the ID. So let's go to find TD dot data set ID. Let's try this. No, it's not working. So let's go to find all the TD first. So after finding all the TD, let's loop over all the TD. So this is a node list of TD. And after finding all the TD, let's go to loop over it. So for, let's use traditional for loop. For let I equals to 0, which is for the for loop. Dot length, and then the I, and then let's say if the ith element of this for loop has the if it has the data set and the ID, and then this data set of ID is the same as our current target ID, which is here. So let's remove this for each loop because it's not working anyway. So here we have the ID. So let's go to check the ID. And if it is the same, let's console log that cell. So let's, at least we must ensure that we are console logging it successfully. So let's try it. So now if I change the 24 to 29 again, let's change it. Now I have console log this four cell. So this is the date, time, to do, and the category. Perfect. So now let's go to, now we need to check it. So switch statement. So we will use the switch statement on the data type. So TD. Okay, so let's not use the switch statement. Let's just basically just do this. So type is date, so let the date be, let the type be the dataset dot dot dataset dot type. So I have stored it in the dataset dot type, and now if the data is the type is date, then I will update its tag. So now I will put this part here. If the type is date, then this note will have an inner text of format date. And otherwise, if it is time to do or category, then this note will have a new inner text of a changed value. And now we don't have the change value, so we need to, we shouldn't use this. We should go to do this one by one. So here, we shouldn't use the if. We should still use switch type. So for the case of dates, then this one will have the inner text of formatted and pass the value of date to it, because we have date here. And for, and then I will break this one here. And then for the case of time, then this cell should have a value of time, a new time, and then break it. And then for the case of to do, then this cell should have inner text of to do, which is the new value. And for the last one, for the case of category, for the case of category, and we will have an inner text of category. So we don't need this one part. So this is how to update it. So let's try it. So now we have, suppose we want to change this one. Suppose we are changing it from to do 9 to to do 4, and then we are changing it from July 22 to July 31. And if we save the changes, we see that it is updated correctly. And the table, the full calendar is updated correctly too. And in the local storage, it is updated too. So that's how to do it with the model box approach. And next, I want to introduce the event clicks of the full calendar. So now if I go to the calendar, full calendar document, and if I go to the check the event click, the event clicking, I can see that we have event click, which we can apply it. So the demonstration is we can apply it when we initialize the calendar. So we can call this event click function. Let me put the rest part in the next lesson. So I will put this three part in the lesson 18, because this is a bit long now. So look forward to seeing you in lesson 18. Thank you. Bye bye.